Welcome to Video Church. My name is Michael James Stone. God talks to me. What can I say? I would like to be like you, maybe in the way that you just sit in a pew and, you know, do what you do, but unfortunately, God talks to me. And because God talks to me, I can't get away with just sitting in a pew. You see, it would be easy if I was just reading my Bible and minding my own business and going about living my life, you know, like everybody else, having a job and, you know, maybe getting married, having kids, raising those kids, planning out their education, their recreation, giving my time over to a certain amount of, you know, worldly time, doing the practical things in life, and, you know, reading the Bible and knowing that it's a religious book, that it has the truth of God in it, and that, you know, God at times speaks certain ways, but, you know, hasn't really done it in quite a while. And then, you know, I go to church and, you know, do my thing there and either sit in a pew or get involved, you know, like Sunday school and, you know, do a few volunteer projects. But unfortunately, I can't do that. Oh, well, God spoke to me and God speaks to me. And to put it bluntly, Jesus won't leave me alone. Now, I know that's a little confusing for some of you, and you don't understand that. So before we get into you think you're better than I am, or you're judging me, brother, or some of the other games that people play or the names that people use on each other, like Pharisee or Sadducee, or you're Pentecostal, or, you know, you're one of those evangelical radicals, you know, or you're something else. Let me kind of put everything in a nutshell and perspective for you. First of all, I'm a Jesus freak. I got saved back in the Jesus movement, and, you know, I got saved at Greg's church, Greg Laurie, and he had a little concert going on at the time, you know, and the room was filled, and I went forward and got saved, you know. Unfortunately, different than you, I didn't just say some words, you know, and have nothing happen. I didn't really say much. As a matter of fact, I had everything happen, and then it was like, wow, I spent the rest of my life trying to figure out what happened. And that's why I'm here today. Oh, man. That's why I am the way I am today. Something happened. Now, in those days, something was happening to lots of people. And I know nowadays, something's not happening to a lot of people. And maybe coming to Videoville Church, you'll begin to understand the difference and you'll pursue that. And maybe you'll find something different that you need to do about it. But all I can say is, what I know, I know. What I have seen, yeah, I've seen. What I've heard, well, you know, I've heard it. And what I've handled with my own hands, well, I've done it, you know. And people, I recently was talking to a pastor that, you know, because he's so young, he hasn't much life experiences. He hasn't gone very far, done many things, or been too much out in the left field, or maybe right field, or maybe out in the field at all, but he's been pretty close to home base. And so, you know, he laughed at me when I first met him, and, you know, kind of was amused by how many times God had moved me around, you know, by his spirit. You know, the wind bloweth whither it will, you neither know where it's coming from nor where it's going. So too is everyone led by the Spirit of God. And being a missionary at large, I was moved around a lot. Well, then he ran into a conflict with me about something, and suddenly it was like, you know, his version of that changed. You know, it's kind of like, wow, you know, it's kind of interesting. And so he vented his frustrations, and I smiled, and I thought, boy, he's not seen what I've seen. He's not heard what I've heard, and he don't know what I know, because God knows. Oy vey, such a deal that God should do something with me, such as I am. Whew. But that's kind of why we have Video Church and why I want to explain this, and maybe you can get a handle on it, is God won't leave me alone. David had a similar experience like that, where if he didn't speak, the very words burned inside him. Elijah kind of felt that way too, that, you know, if he didn't open up his mouth, that it was going to explode out of him. David wrote that when I went to remain silent, you know, I groaned within me, and, you know, it's just like amazing what it is like when God intervenes in a life. And I know probably about now you're, you know, kind of amused and kind of wondering, you know, if you don't know me or you've never seen a video or you don't understand video church, but we're going to look at A.W. Tozer for a moment and see what he has to say about this thing of hearing God speak. Because you see, everything that I've done for the last 40 years has been based upon one experience I had, and that's not salvation. Now, God has done the same experience over and over and over again in a different way and a different means, and has changed it and rearranged the way that He's spoken to me at different times, in different ways, and in different settings. I think that's to teach you. Or He's called me a new name, and I'm kind of fascinated by it because I really don't know how to say this, because it sounds so weird to me, because I'm not a pastor. Let's clarify this. I'm not a pastor. I attended Calvary Chapel at Costa Mesa back in the 70s, you know, and went there for about 2 years, you know, and I was there pretty much because I was a hippie and I was living in my car, and then I was living with some Christian roommates. I didn't have a job, but I went to church 7 days a week. And I don't know if you understand what that means in those days, but in current days, I guess you could say that I went to church 7 Sundays in a row. In other words, I kept going to church, you know, over and over and over again. And on Sundays, I kind of went more than once, you know, I kind of went twice, you know, and Wednesdays, you know, kind of went once, but Thursdays was once, you know. There were some days I went twice. And then I also worked as a volunteer in the tape lending library in those days, back in when everybody was volunteering instead of being paid. And not everyone went into becoming a pastor, but there's some pretty big names that did. Greg and Raul and Mike and John. And, you know, there's a bunch of guys that, you know, that some of them had gone to school, some of them hadn't, you know, and some of them went on to become big and some of them didn't, you know, and we all know the stories, you know, or if you look it up on the internet, you can find it, you know, Chuck Smith's church, you know, Calvary Chapel, Costa Mesa. It was an interesting time, but for me, it was like odd man out, because I kept getting these weird experiences. God kept talking to me. I just can't get around that. I'm sorry. I wish I could tell you I made it up. It's kind of hard to deny. I wish I could tell you that, you know, it was like a blinding light and it wasn't really God. You know, Paul had to, you know, say, well, you know, you guys may have seen a light, but I saw God, you know, and God talked to me. You know, kind of went to heaven to find out the truth. We won't talk about that right now because I don't want to blow you out of the water. But we want to get to Tozer because, you see, A.W. Tozer was a man that lived in our generation, or at least my generation, maybe not yours if you're young. But he was a man that was called a prophet. Now, in modern days, you don't hear too many people being called a prophet. Matter of fact, rarely do you see too many people, except in extreme Pentecostal movement, perform the fact of being a prophet. You know, most of them claim it and name it and run around and shame it because they really can't perform what they say they can do. The only reason I mention that is because I've had to confront prophets in the modern 20th century, and no, they're not. You know, matter of fact, any of them that cross my path, be very careful. I've run into false prophets a lot. They know that I've been there. God spoke to me and I had to talk. Ew, and I'm not a prophet. Let me clarify that. A, I'm not a pastor, and B, I'm not a prophet. Whoa! Boy, what are you? That's a good question. We're getting there. So A.W. Tozer was a man that was called a prophet because what he spoke to and how he spoke and what he wrote and how he wrote was to pastors and to the church at large, and he was what he considered himself, a minor of all prophets, the minor prophet of all. And he said things that came true, and he said things from God that accurately fit the circumstances in life that we live in. And so a lot of people love his writings. He was from the Christian Missionary Alliance, which we would say the CMA or Evangelical Missionary Alliance. I don't even know what the Alliance Church now is what they call it. But I think it was the Christian Missionary and Alliance Church, something like that. And God used him, point blank. God spoke through him, God wrote through him, and God used his writings even today to speak to us. And that's what we're going to read, and maybe you'll get a word out of this that'll make sense to you. And maybe it'll help you to understand what I'm saying about God spoke to me. Because I'm not exaggerating. We're talking, let's be clear, God Almighty, you know, maker of heaven and earth, the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, you know, the father of Jesus, that is the creator of all with the Son and with the Spirit, three in one. So let's clarify all our hermeneutic and homiletic and get all our ducks in a row so that we could quack like, you know, Donald Duck that's out there on the television shows and reality shows. But the fact of the matter is that I know what I'm saying, and I'm trying to tell you I am what I'm saying and saying what I am. So, you know, I'm not exaggerating the words any at all. So you can hear what it says and understand it clearly. God spoke audibly to me and used my name, and there was no mistaking who he's talking to or the fact that I talk to him and he talks to me and we have conversation. That's the challenging part. What you do after that is your own business, but let's just clarify some things from A.W. Tozer. And this book is called Renewed Day by Day because Vidivo, the ministry that I have that God gave me, that I enjoy in order to employ that which is filled me up with that I got to get out of my system, is just simply making videos of devotionals that God speaks through in order to share his word to you in a more intimate and personal way that you might understand who Jesus is, what Jesus is, and then, whoa, big shock, you might even discover Jesus, period, and ask him into your life or ask him to be more real or even begin to hear his voice or know him in a still small voice or in some way, circumstantially or circumferentially or corporeally, or, you know, we could say, I was going to say what the word for church was in theology, but I think it's Christology, but anyways, it doesn't matter. Here's what we're going to read, and it's from A.W. Tozer, and it says, "A blessed fact, God has never been silent. God hath in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things," from Hebrews 1, 1 and 2. I think it may be accepted as axiomatic that God is continually trying to speak to man. He desires to communicate himself, to impart his holy ideas to those of his creatures capable of receiving them. The second person of the Godhead is called the Word of God. That is the mind of God in expression, that is God himself, Jesus. Are you aware that many Christians appear to believe that God spoke the Holy Scriptures into being and then lapsed into silence? A silence that will not be broken until God calls all men before him into judgment. These Christians think that once it was done, God never spoke again, even through his Son. If that is true, we have the Bible as a deposit of embalmed truth, which scribe and theologian must decipher as they can. And as a matter of fact, that's what most Christians do. The view is extremely injurious to the Christian soul, for it holds that God is no longer speaking. And thus we are shut up to our intellects for the understanding and apprehension of truth. According to this notion, the human mind becomes the final arbiter of truth as well as the organ for its reception into the soul. Now, the blessed fact is that God is not silent, and he has never been silent, but is speaking in his universe. The written word is effective because and only because the living word is speaking in heaven and the living voice is sounding in the earth. And it is the Spirit that beareth witness because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. 1 John 5, 6, and 7. If I could paraphrase Tozer so that you can understand it. God speaks audibly. God wants to speak to you. God chose to speak to me. Because he chose to speak to me, he's made me into being now a new title, because I used to just be a missionary at large. He's called me a preacher, which, you know, I'm not real fond of that title, you know. But when I kind of thought of it and I walked outside today, and I had to spend some time outside today because I'm in this apartment and it's on the third floor and it's winter and there's snow out and everything else. But God sent a north wind and kind of blew the clouds away. It's sunny now. God sent a warm wind and he kind of melted the snow away and it's kind of like nice out. And I didn't really have my winter clothes on, so I went ahead and just put some shoes on and walked outside, and God shined the light on me and he began to speak to me. And he said, "You are the preacher." And I went, "Oh, now that I like, the preacher, not a preacher, but the preacher." You see, in the Old Testament, Solomon was called the preacher. And about 38 years ago, I've been a Christian 40 years, about 38 years ago, I told God I wanted to know why, I wanted to know why. Just about everything. You know, I wanted to know why, you know, pastors, you know, lied to me, some of them. Why they didn't tell the truth on some things, you know, why they did what they did, or why theology was, you know, kind of like in its way, and why some churches did things certain ways, and why people couldn't get along today or to yesterday or back then, and, you know, all kinds of whys. I had lots of whys. You know, I always wanted to know why, because I had gotten so saved, I was like, wow, man, I was like, let's just love everybody, you know, and sure enough, it worked for me, so I wondered why it didn't work for everybody else. And so I was amazed at the reality of God taking me on this long Solomon journey that, whoa, yeah, I got wisdom. But, you know, the price that I paid was like Solomon. I mean, it wasn't just with women and wives and those kind of things, though I have been married more than once. But it was about those experiences that God's using object lessons to bring home the specific lesson that you read in the Word. In other words, everything in the Old Testament that people lived were used as object lessons because they were learning that as an object lesson because they were the object of the lesson. And so are you. Today, you are an object lesson of God using your life to witness to and give testimony to the angels in heaven. They are, as we're told in Hebrews, looking down, examining your life to see and to understand, according to Romans, what this grace is and what this mercy is that God's allowing you to keep going, doing what you're doing and getting away with it. Because they don't get it. Satan was cast out, but you're getting away with it. So, you know, that may not be exactly why they are watching you, but they're watching you. And the interesting thing is that people don't seem to believe in angels. I've met angels, so I'm not a Pentecostal. I keep trying to tell you, look, I'm not Pentecostal, man. I'm telling you. I was just as much like, no. And as soon as some Pentecostal comes up to me and tells me that you met an angel, I'll be going, no. You know, in my mind, I'm not going to hurt their feelings, but I'm going to be going, I don't think so. But then again, you know, they may have. I know I have, but I can only speak for myself. I can't speak for others. You know, your experience, hey, you know, can't help you. Don't know what to tell you. But as far as me, yeah, oh, no problem. You know, not on a regular basis, but, you know, I could say probably about four or five times, you know. I'm waiting for the Lord to kind of tell me more. And I'm going, all right, fine. You know, there might be more, but I don't know how many, you know, exactly. Okay. You know, that kind of fits, you know, because he's kind of like going, you don't even know. I'm going, yeah, I know. And, you know, God says that our thoughts are not his thoughts, neither are his ways our ways, any more than, you know, as high as the heavens are above the earth, so is his thoughts above our thoughts, and so are his ways above our ways, and beyond our finding out. So we're not always going to know how many angels we've met, or if we have, or if you have. According to Jesus, you know, you should have met some by entertaining, you know, strangers coming to your door, you know. But we wanted to reiterate that about this video church because that's what we're basing everything on. God speaks, and he's not silent. Not only that, there's a popular song out that is true. God's not dead, he's sure alive, but he's not necessarily living on the inside. He's living in the universe. Now, you have a spirit inside that's living on the inside that represents him, and it may cause you to feel like a roaring lion at times, or like a gentle lamb at times, or like a loving person at times, isn't that a shock? Or like a person who's nonviolent, which, by the way, is what God said. Let me clarify, what God said. How many times can we say this? What God said to do, nonviolence. Because you see, there's no room for violence in heaven. None. If you're learning violence and to be violent, if you're an angry person, if you're, you know, one of those types of people that, you know, have to go to anger management and you have to kind of like rearrange your brain, you know, and get your life back in order because you got PTSD because nobody or everybody lied to you about going to serve your country and they didn't warn you about the consequences. Well, Jesus did. So, you know, you get what you pay for. You know, I mean, you just didn't pay attention to what the word said, you know, and I'm sorry, but you got lied to, just like I did. So, you know, I kind of had to deal with that myself on certain levels and get into the Bible and study it because I found out there are a lot of people out there that'll lie to you. They'll tell you what they believe in and philosophically, you know, it's like, well, yeah, okay, I got you philosophically, but you know what? I'm not into philosophy or, you know, intellectually. Well, you know, I kind of got an intellect, you know, I could think, but you know what? I kind of got a spirit too. And you know what? Between the two, man, you're in trouble if you don't have the Spirit of God to lead you. If you don't have the Holy Spirit inside you, if God isn't speaking directly to you, you're in for trouble. Because there'd be times where you're going to find out, I don't think that's right. And you're going to let it slide and you're going to follow that and find out it was wrong. And I don't like that. That's why I went the long way to get to where I am today. And so when God spoke to me today about Vidivo Church, He used some things in my life as object lessons, some people that recently I dealt with, you know, at a church recently, you know, that I was helping, you know, in some ways, you know, in other ways they were helping me. I mean, you know, we all work together. God uses us all together, cooperatively working together. They're still brothers and sisters, but they're just, you know, doing their thing. They got, you know, a learning curve that's definitely a learning curve. And I got thrown a curveball and I went, wow. Try that pitch again. Ain't gonna happen twice, baby. But yeah, I got thrown a curveball and God said, you know, it's okay. It's just baby steps. And most churches that start off their first year, they're pretty messed up. You know, they got a lot of learning and growing to do and pretty messed up, you know, but you know, they enjoy what they do, you know, because it's just like a baby, you know, the baby can, you know, roll around and baby doo-doo, you know, and think it's funny and have fun and laugh and sing, you know. And it's kind of what happens in churches, you know. Some people can smell the poop, you know. Diaper needs changing, you know. Take care of it. But that's kind of what happens in all of our life when we go into something new. And I'm sure it's going to happen here in Vidivo Church, although I pray not so. Because having been prepared for 40 years, you know, I've been brought through a lot of interesting experiences that, you know, it's like, well, okay, you know, and learn from that one, you know, learn from that one. So what I share now is things I've learned. I don't share things that are doing, you know, because it's like, hey, you know, if I think I'm still trying to figure it out, I ain't talking about, you know, that. I'm talking about what I've seen, what I've heard, and what I've handled with my own hands. And maybe that's why God's calling me, you know, Michael James Stone - the preacher. And that's what I'm going to put on my little, you know, kind of like, you know, you have to put these little things to give credit where credit is due, or you have to put them on so somebody can sue you. I'm going after that guy. I know his name, you know. Well, that's what I am. You can call me the preacher, you know, if you want to. And, you know, if you meet me, well, don't call me pastor. Don't call me minister. Don't call me anything else, you know, of all those titles that the church has, you know, for prophet and deacon and pastor and elder and apostle and whatever. Because I know I'm a missionary at large. That I know. I've been laid on hands umpteen times, you know, to be a missionary at large. And I've gone on missions, you know, and I'm still on a mission from God. You know, I mean, everybody is on a mission from God. You might not know that. But you're on a mission from God because your first responsibility after getting saved was to tell someone about it. That's a mission. Sorry. And then he says, go out and, you know, teach all nations. And some of them says, go out and make disciples of all nations. And some of them says to go out and tell somebody, you know. And one way or another, God's speaking to you, you know. And if you want to make it intellectual, well, intellectually, you're in trouble. Emotionally, you're in trouble. Intellect, emotion, philosophically, you screwed. So spiritually, get on with it. I did. Wow, what a life. And that's why it's exciting to see what God is doing. Pepsi, by the way. If you don't know me, I drink a lot of Pepsi. I enjoy Pepsi. I have a ileostomy. That is a bag on my side that prevents me from, well, actually, it doesn't prevent me from doing anything because I go swimming, I play football, I go hiking, I can do anything. I go dancing, you know what I mean? There isn't anything I can't do, but it requires me to adjust my lifestyle so that I drink more fluids or I drink something for gas, you know, because that's what Pepsi does for me. It kind of chews up the gas, you know, and kind of expedites the hot air, because if you think you've been hearing hot air, it ain't there. But the fact of the matter is that my physical body is capable of doing miraculous things because of the spiritual body that God has given me that I live in over these 40 years. And if you've been a Christian a short period of time, I can only tell you this. As you grow spiritually with your spiritual body, your physical body is going to deteriorate. And it's going to, at first, put up a battle that you have to crucify that sucker, and it's going to fight you every step of the way. And until you die, you are going to sin. You're going to sin every day, probably, you know, and you're going to try to fight sin and say you don't sin and say you didn't do this. But according to Jesus, you know, you blew it. So every night you ask God to forgive you. You know, if we confess our sins, he's faithful just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But he's not wanting you to feel guilty because he's already paid the price for your sins. Jesus died on the cross so that you could be forgiven, not only forgiven of the sins you had done, but the sins that you were going to do and the sins that you still yet will do. Because until you're perfect and made perfect, you won't be perfected until that day when Jesus presents you before his Father with exceeding joy, a spotless bride without blemish before God Almighty, and he marries you to himself. Till that day, dude, you messed up. So that's why we have Video Church. We have Video Church because for me, you know, if I could put it into perspective for you, I'm getting rid of some of that hot air gas that we were talking about. Oh, it's kind of like when people have a bowel movement in the morning, those old timers, you know, I don't have bowel movements. Unfortunately, I don't, you know, do those kind of things that those people do because my ileostomy is permanent. I've always had a bag on my side for probably about 30 years now. And I've done everything. You know, I'm not disabled. Well, sometimes I'm disabled, but sometimes I'm enabled. So it depends on what God does, because sometimes God gives me phenomenal jobs and I'm able to work them for a season. And then all of a sudden God says, no, kaboom. And then I'm sick and I'm laying in bed, whatever, you know, whatever. But no, I'm not, you know, dying anymore. You know, I've nearly died 3 times. But God has taken me through some miraculous experiences because, to put it bluntly, God spoke to me. And God speaks to me. And Jesus doesn't leave me alone. He wants me to be changed from what I was back in the early days of the 70s, you know, before I got saved, to what I am today and to continue on in that with which he's perfecting in me. And so, in sharing this word, in Video Church, we wanted to give you a hindsight oversight of what we're doing, and it's an internet-based church. We meet in the home if we want to meet in the home, but to put it bluntly, we record, as you can probably tell, recordings that are designed to be exactly the same as your foolish megachurch. Because you see, looking at a megadome and metronome and being in some kind of coliseum seating and, you know, looking at the stadium and, you know, watching, you know, the thing happening on a big screen, well, we do that, you know, sort of, you know, it's kind of like, well, you know, we make this little scene, you know, and setting for that, and then we put up the little videos, you know, but it works the same way. And the Spirit of God doesn't need you to be in a metronome and a coliseum, you know, and to have thousands of people around you, you know, because after all, you're probably drinking coffee and, you know, kind of doing your thing, you know, and kind of like, you know, not really participating. But in this way, with Video Church, with it being internet-based and an internet ministry, you're able to stop the action when you need to go do something. You're able to rewind and stop and hear and record or to pay attention to what parts are important to you. You're able to pause and maybe listen to some music for a few minutes so that the Holy Spirit can kind of like, you know, get you into worship mode, you know. And we have, and I'm going to point it out as though they were there, because when you see this later, right now you can't see it because I'm obviously sitting in front of a living room, but over here, you're going to see a big screen which is going to have probably either announcements, or it'll have worship songs with lyrics in them, or sometimes it might have some special presentation, but it'll be a big screen over here, even as I'm on this big screen outside of what you can see. That's kind of like, you know, on stage. And then over here, up here in this corner, there'll be similar to that. There'll be a different variety of possibilities for you to play of a video nature that may be contemporary Christian music, or maybe it'll be classical Christian music or some type of music. We want to have the two variations of worship services. And if this becomes, you know, somewhere else, we'll always probably have the main screen, which will be in the center, and then opposite screens on the outside, whether it be like a smartphone, you know, and you can see that and have a variety of choices there, or whether it be an iPad, you know, of some type that we see over to the left of me, you know, you'll be able to make choices. But these will be on the internet, on the website at vidivo.org. You'll always be able to access vidivo.org and to find that which you need in the right place in the right time, because the Holy Spirit will lead you. Now, we also are going to do some live broadcasts, but the live broadcasts are no different than canned broadcasts. They're exactly the same. You know, nobody's calling in, so what difference does it make? So the point of the live broadcast is simply so we can put them on a live server somewhere else that people go there to see them, and they'll be canned. You know, so it's like, well, you know, same thing. Eventually, we might do live broadcasts simultaneous where people will watch and watch, you know, because they have their own little idiosyncrasies to watch it live, you know. It's no different than being canned because, you know, I don't do any editing. What you see is what you get. What I've handled is what I've done. And that's kind of a unique perspective, I know, but it's something that's true to the way that God wants to go, because he's taken me from where I was and he's used me behind the scenes in many churches and many ministries doing all the different functions that you could possibly do in a church. Yeah, I've done most of them. Now, I might not have sat there and done the legalities, you know, of organizing and contacting, you know, like the health insurance agencies or, you know, the insurance agencies or stuff like that, but I've been a church secretary, you know, so, you know, other people have done it, you know, kind of like, well, you know, and I've been, you know, leading worship, you know, I've done that too, you know, played guitar before I had arthritis act up so bad, and used to lead worship, you know, Calvary, oh, I don't know, Calvary Anchorage, you know, and, you know, done sound almost every church I've been at, you know, until recently, you know, one pastor went off the deep end over me doing sound because, you know, I told him some things he wasn't ready to hear. And, well, you know, I was like, okay, well, that was a learning curve. You know, I don't think I'll do that again. But, you know, I mean, you know, Calvary Costa Mesa, Calvary Klamath Falls, Calvary Anchorage. I mean, you know, man, Calvary Jerusalem, you know, that was a bunch of sound equipment, you know, setups and, you know, running quite a few different places, different boards, you know, and I've never been, you know, like on the sound synthesizers or sound equipment, you know, as far as multi-mixing like at Mama Joe's, you know, in Hollywood. But, you know, I've done some of that on my own synthesizers, you know, when I had a synthesizer and I was really into worship. But, you know, you kind of get out of that and God moves on to something else, you know. But I've done a lot of functions in the church, you know, at different times, elder and deacon and pastor and preacher, whatever you want. But I've never been a preacher, you know, not really. I've been evangelist in a sense by being a missionary at large, because a missionary at large really is an apostle. I mean, that's what they are. A missionary at large is somebody that goes out and is sent by God, you know, and they talk to God and they know God and they do what God tells them to do. You know, I mean, we changed that in some ways in modern missionary little outreaches, you know, which are just kind of like, well, you know, kind of like the 70 being sent out or something, but you know, that's kind of a short-term mission. It's still missionary, you know. But the point is that God has started this video church for a reason. And it's not to compete against anyone. It's not to be in opposition to anyone. It's not to be, you know, in conflict with anyone. It's to share Jesus in a personal, intimate way. That means that sharing Jesus in a personal, intimate way, there's an expectation of you being able to hear from and know from that God is speaking through his son to you to get you to know him so that you don't have to hear me, but you can hear him speak to you. Now, some people say they do hear God speak to them through me, and you can check out some of my videos, you know, and find out for yourself. Video Today, Video Perspective, Video Gospel. I mean, you know, we have a whole bunch of videos out there that are about 3,000 to 5,000, you know, on YouTube, you know, and you can Google us, you know, Google Video. Google Michael James Stone, you know, Google Video Church, you know, I mean, Google is it, you know, I mean, we do everything freely because God wanted to raise this ministry up to be a testimony against to put it bluntly, most Calvary chapels, because they're not doing what they said from the beginning, freely you receive, freely give. And some, you know, other ministries that have claimed to be free, that they aren't. Because God wanted to show free is free. There's no question about taking up a love offering or taking some kind of like, well, you know, you got to cover your expenses, you know, so we'll give you this money on the side under the table. We'll take you out to lunch, you know, we'll pay your traveling expenses. We'll have you come speak, but we'll pay for the travel, you know. No. Free is free. So, you know, if you ever, you know, ask me to come, good luck. How I get there is going to be questionable. You know, you'll have to come get me, you know. But no, I mean, you know, I'll travel with you or something, but, you know, because that's like two or more together. But no, we don't do that. We don't get money for speaking. I mean, I've had money offered me lots of times. You know, I've gone to a church recently and, you know, I spoke to them for quite a while, you know, and they were blessed out of their minds. You know, they wanted me back, you know, and all this stuff. No, God told me to speak there one time, you know, and that was enough. And pastor paid me, you know, and I went, what's this for? He goes, well, that's what we pay speakers. I went, oh. So I brought it home, you know, and I said, well, you know, I should always pray about it. So I, you know, took it politely, you know, and I came home, you know, and kind of went. I didn't go, look at me, I'm professional. But I learned early at Calvary Costa Mesa that, you know, most of the people that were on staff, they were on staff. And most of the volunteers, we had some real unique experiences. So the volunteers seemed to be anointed by the Holy Spirit in certain ways. I didn't see the staff being anointed the same way. So I didn't really want to ever be staff, you know, at Calvary. Sorry, it doesn't look like one of those enjoyable experiences for me. You guys look like you still got some learning to do, you know. I'd rather be volunteers, you know. And we had 40 volunteers at one time at the tape lending library, you know, and gradually that whittled itself down, you know, and gradually they got rid of, you know, the volunteers, and eventually volunteers were less more at Calvary than, you know, used to be, and pretty soon it was all paid people, you know, and I was like, that was a bummer, you know, kind of sad see that go, but I was already gone by then. But my point is this, when they gave me that check, I had to sit on it for 24 hours, but I was back there within 48 hours giving the check back to the pastor. It was like, there's no way. I mean, you know, this isn't, that's not what I do. I don't share this because I'm going to get money or I'm remunerated or in some way. And he was blown away. I mean, it was surprising to him, but he said, okay, you know, I kind of got it, because what I taught on was about trusting in the Lord with all your heart, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, which you'll hear a lot of. And, you know, that God speaks to you, and that, you know, don't think you're something special if you're Pentecostal, because this was a Pentecostal church. And another time I had somebody, you know, God bless her, you know, send me a big amount of money. I mean, it was a sizable chunk of money. I mean, it was some like, oh boy, honey, we got the money, you know, and I could have run out and spent it. I mean, it was that easy. And it was tempting. But, you know, I mean, after 39 years or 38 years of not taking money for anything, it was easy to say, no, thank you. You know, I mean, I even used it as a teaching to burn it, you know, on the camera, because I couldn't tell who it was from the name, you know, for sure. But, you know, later on I figured it out. But, you know, burned it and said, you know, thank you, but this is what we do. You know, we don't really, it's an offering that you've given to God. So let's together give it to God, because it's not for me. I'm not going to use the money. I'm not going to take the money. And that's between you and God, you know. So you keep the money and use it the way you want to. But for you and I, you know, as a sacrifice to the Lord, let's burn it and give the ashes, you know, to the Lord and make an offering to him, you know, and see what he'll do with you and bless you, you know. And the person contacted me, and eventually I figured out that that was the person. I went, wow, awesome. The Lord blessed her. And so we're not about money here, you know. I mean, you want to be prayed for? Great. We'll pray for you. You know, you want to come over? I'll lay hands. You know, you want to call me? We've got a phone number that we use, Google Voice, because you can call there from anywhere in the country, actually anywhere in the world, and you can leave a message. I mean, I don't really have it ringing all the time at the house, because, you know, sometimes I'm doing this, you know, and it's like phones going would not be a good thing. So, you know, you have a number that you can contact, and I can't remember the number, but it's something like 353-487, last four digits are 8756, you know. There's a good reason for that. Birthday. But anyways, our phone number, you know, so you can always contact us. It'll be permanent. It's Google Voice, so it's permanent. And you can get a hold of us on the internet, you know. Most of the times I'm usually up until 2014, I mean, I've been on Facebook, Michael James Stone, for a long time, you know, doing Facebook to build that up. But we'll probably be going back to, you know, only spot hit and miss on Facebook by way of posting mainly on Blogger and on the website and then reposting to Facebook and to friend feed and to Blogger and to WordPress and to Twitter and to Pinterest and whatever else comes along. But you really don't need to. You see, what we share is what God knows you're right where you are, telling you exactly what you need to hear. Because right now, I know God is speaking to someone there, and some of you are really knowing that, you know, God is talking to you, wanting you to get involved and get more involved in your local church. So you probably don't need this, but you can augment sometimes your studies with things that maybe will make sense to you from here, or maybe it won't. You can go check out Vidivo and see if those things help, because they're topical, some of them. You know, like Vidivo perspective is a, you know, viewpoint of looking at it from God's point of view as opposed to man's point of view, because a lot of times, like especially with Duck Dynasty, people are looking at it from man's point of view, but they have no idea what God has to say about the whole subject. None whatsoever. Man, I don't know why they don't, but because they get excited, you know, and they get whapped up into issues and they don't pay attention to what God has said in his word and then ask him what he wants now to how to apply the word. Don't know how people get all caught up in the duck season during Christmas season, but they do, you know, oh well. But in Vidivo Church, we will be expanding continually, and we'll have some hangouts where at Google Hangouts you can kind of like, you know, have a chat room conversation of on video. And we'll be doing that soon. You know, we're looking forward to trying that maybe in January, but I doubt it, probably February. We'll be doing a lot of things like, you know, outreaches in a lot of ways, you know, that you could participate. We do have some street stuff that goes taking it to the street that we like to get involved with, you know, in music, in worship, and in dance. And, you know, maybe you'd like to get involved in that. But the point is this: you live where you live, and so do I. But I give what I got. And so you can take what you have and you can make use of what you've been given and apply the two by way of the Holy Spirit and do something with your salvation that maybe you've never thought of doing before. Saving a soul from hell. Sharing your testimony with someone else. Learning how to be a witness. Learning how to maybe not be satisfied with not knowing God, but begin to realize there's more to Christianity than sucking your thumb, and that God wants you to know him. As it says here in Tozer's book, Day by Day, Renewed, that he wants you, if you're ready to hear this, to hear him speak. God wants to speak to you. God wants you to hear his voice every day, but he wants you to hear his voice audibly. And I'll be honest with you, there's a lot to be said for hearing his voice, you know, internally, where you hear that still small voice and you get this impression, or you try the open door thing. You know, I mean, I always love that open door thing. It's nowhere found in scripture, an open door, but that's okay. You know, he says, I present before you an open door in heaven, but that's not what he meant, you know, about what Christians use it as. But, you know, they go, well, you know, because the door that he opens up in heaven is always open. You know, he doesn't slam it shut. Well, in the rapture maybe, but point is, you got an open door. But here's the point. This circumstantial, we used to call in Christendom, providence of God. The providence of God is what modern Christianity calls an open door. Christians like to say, well, you know, the door was open, so I went through and I tried it and it worked. So because it worked, it was God's will. Okay, you know, it'll work. You know, you got a 50-50 chance of that being God's will. You know, but, you know, somewhere in there, you know, you want to get to that, nevertheless, not my will, thy will be done. And some people will pray and say, well, God, if it's not your will, close the door. But since it's open, I'm going through it. You know, and they'll run through it, you know, as fast as they can before the door closes. Now, me, you know, like I said, I can only go by my own experiences. I have had God tell me not to go through an open door. I have told me, go through an open door. I have had God tell me to be led by circumstance, have told me to be not led by your circumstance. God has told me to walk through a door that was closed, and I have walked through the door that was closed, and he's told me sometimes to, you know, try the door, and it was closed, and I couldn't get through. You know, I was like, well, what was up with that? You know, and, you know, God didn't tell me. He just wanted me to try it and do and experience those things to learn. And I did, you know, and later I know how to teach that, you know, to anyone about anything. You know, I mean, you want to know how to hear God speak? There's lots of ways, you know. I mean, you could come over to my house and before you leave, I might keep you up for a few days, but before you leave, you will have heard God speak to you personally. So, you know, I mean, to me, that's pretty important. So I will treat it as such, and you will hear God speak before you leave. You'll know that. My wife, when I met her, didn't hear God speak. She wasn't saved, you know, and so she got saved. She fought me a long time. She argued with me. She debated with me. She didn't really, you know, develop under my tutelage at all because I kept her separate. But she watched. And what she saw and what she experienced in her own life made her realize God speaks. And God has spoken to her and God is speaking to her. Now God speaks to her directly. And she's pretty amazed by that. Now, her experiences are a little less direct, you know, but she's getting closer and more so every day, you know, amazing me. I'm just like blown away because I'm like, well, you know, I don't do anything. I don't go out and teach her, try to be a priest in the home. That's pretty stupid. Or to be some kind of like, you know, I'm the head and you're the body. And you know what? We work this out. No, it doesn't work that way either. You know, it's more like this. You know, you're both two people that are living together, that you've got a church. You're both part of that church. You're both focusing in on Jesus. You're both learning to follow Jesus. You're both learning to do what Jesus says, period. That's it. Pure and simple. That's what marriage is. It's just a contract. It's all it is. You do happen to become one in the spirit, one in the flesh, one in the Lord, but that's what Christians do anyways, whether you're in marriage or not. That's what God prayed for them in John when he said, I pray that they may be one as we are one, as you are in the Son and the Son is in you, and God, we are one, and we've been one in everybody. And I prayed also for those that hear the words that they would be one too, you know, and so we do this a lot because that's first unique to me. You know, it's not Tebow, you know, or whatever he does. And it's not Copernic, but it's Jesus Gypsy. One way, one God, one faith, one baptism, one hope, one Lord. Now, it's interesting that Jesus said what we have been talking about since the beginning. My sheep hear my voice and they know me. And Jesus said, they will not follow the voice of another. And Jesus said these things because the voice can't be a written word. Because it can't be. A voice is a voice and an ear is an ear. And so if a voice is a voice and an ear and is an ear, then God is going to speak to you and you need to hear what it is that the Spirit of God would say to you. Now, I'll admit you could do this if you want to. You know, you could play a little compromise game a little bit, you know, and kind of like do this fast shuffle that pastors do. And elders do, you know, kind of like the church does, you know, they do the herky jerky, you know, and they go, well, you know, we don't want the people to get confused. So what we want to do is we want to make sure that they are in the Word. So they study the Word and the Word won't conflict with itself. But if we tell them that the Word is always accurate and God is not, well, you know, they'll figure that out. Don't go there. Matter of fact, you can find plenty of scriptures and plenty of contradiction in the scriptures to contradict yourself until God shows you how it's not a contradiction. Because I can show you the contradiction and then I can show you how it's not a contradiction at the same time as being a contradiction that God can still make it a non-contradiction. Because, quite frankly, the Holy Spirit makes applicable the means with which we are able to apply that living word that God makes quicken to us in a personal circumstance that we cannot make the decision ourselves to make that applicable by way of private interpretation, but rather it is of the Holy Spirit's application that he does it to us so that God would be the one directing us, so that we would be led by the Spirit and not of our flesh, so that it would be he that receives the glory and that not of ourselves, so that it would be back to the realization that God is in us, both to do and to will of his good pleasure, to accomplishing the workmanship that we are supposed to go out and do according to the works that he wants us to accomplish, so that he would receive the glory and honor and praise by way of his Spirit doing that inside of which we could not have done for ourselves because of the grace that's been given to us. We're able to do those things because we're forgiven and God has restored a relationship to us that we've had all along that we could have had should we have been forgiven by God, and that we would have found ourselves in relationship to the Almighty, knowing, listening, and following his lead as he's told us in Deuteronomy that he would do. I'll whisper in your ear. I'll tell you to go to the left. I'll tell you to go to the right. I'll tell you to stand up. I'll tell you to sit down. I'll tell you to go forward. I'll tell you to go back. I'll make it as obvious as a pillar of fire by day and or by night and a cloud by day. Well, for me, that's pretty obvious. Sorry, like I said, I'm Michael James Stone,
the preacher, I guess. Missionary at large. Okay. Jesus Gypsy. Oh, yeah. But I'm Michael James Stone, Videbo Church. God speaks to me. Imagine that. God speaking to me. Such a deal. Man, I can only think of one other thing that's just as amazing. God speaks to you. You're just not listening.